Last talk before the next break, Eric Shershen of University of Tennessee at Knoxville, bryophyte communities change over a 12-year period along an elevational gradient in Great Smoky Mountains National Park.
All righty, thank you, Paul. So as Paul said, I'm gonna be talking about how bryophytes has changed within the park over the past 12 years. And so we can notice on the figure on the right, where high elevation is located with that dark brown and low elevation is in that dark green, that within the park, it's topographically diverse. And with that diversity of landscape comes diversity in biodiversity and biotic components. And back in the 1950s, an ecologist by the name of Whitaker went through and defined all the different elevation zones by their dominant tree stand, with the highest peaks being the spruce zone, the spruce-fir zone, and the fir zone. These are not the only components of these ecosystems, and bryophytes are actually major understory components, specifically thinking about mosses and liverworts, which we can see in these pictures completely cover the landscape. These organisms provide key ecosystem services, such as providing a habitat for macro and microinvertebrates, providing nesting material for birds and squirrels, sequestering carbon, protecting seedlings from being washed away and from drought stress, as well as preventing erosion. But there are different disturbances that could potentially negatively impact the ability of these species to perform such ecosystem services. Things like Tori mentioned earlier, like invasion, which impacts canopy cover. Back in the 1950s, the Balsam Woolly Adelgid was first found and kind of went through, and since then to the 1990s, killed off about 90% of the fir trees. Since then, there have been a few studies that have shown that there's been a general recovery of fir trees in these high elevation ecosystems. With this increase in canopy cover, we'd expect the microclimate to have a decrease in temperature, a decrease in light availability, and an increase in humidity, all of which can negatively impact, or at least, or some in some instances, positively impact the bryophytes in the understory. And that kind of begs the question of how bryophyte communities changed over time. And we can break this big question down into three smaller questions. Those being, are changes in bryophyte community composition predicted by any environmental factors? How has bryophyte diversity changed over time? And how has bryophyte abundance changed over time? You'll note that these questions have huge time components, and obviously 2020, or current day at least, is a good one point to compare to. And we were fortunate enough to know another study, or another researcher, Sarah Stehn, our co-author, who also looked at how bryophytes changed within the park. Back in 2007, she established plots and measured and quantified bryophyte percent cover and bryophyte community composition. She also quantified canopy cover within her plots, and she ultimately found that bryophyte communities do change along this elevational gradient. And so I went back out to 45 of those 20 by 20 meter plots and ran her exact same methods, wherein I ran three 20 meter transect lines, where at each of the white parts of this transect line, I would sample which bryophyte species were present or absent, as well as how much of that transect line those species touched. And that got me my abundance data, as well as what species were present or absent. I also took a fisheye photo denoted by this circle at the center of each plot, which is basically just a picture of the canopy. And I can convert that into binary pixels, where black represents all the vegetation that covers the canopy, and the white opens, or white represents the open canopy, thus giving us an idea of what the canopy openness looked like. And I'll be referring that as gap fraction for the rest of this talk. And so great, I have all of this abundance data, I have all these species presence and absence data, as well as canopy cover data. And so now I can start to answer my questions. For this first question, I ran two general linear models, wherein change in species richness and change in percent cover between those two time points were our response variables, with elevation, change in gap fraction, slope, and aspect were our predictor variables. After performing a stepwise AIC function, I found that change in species richness was predicted by elevation, change in gap fraction, and aspect. But elevation was the only significant predictor in this model. For change in percent cover, I found that elevation and aspect were predictors, but neither of them were significant predictors. So really interesting to think about how elevation is a significant predictor for change in species richness. And we have these other environmental factors that might predict change in species richness and change in percent cover, but they're not significantly in terms of the model. And so now we answer that first question, but we still have how bryophyte diversity changed over time and how bryophyte abundance changed over time. To do this, I divided all the plots into the respective elevation zones, that spruce fir, spruce and fir zones, and performed a paired t-test to see if there was a significant difference between the two time points. And so here on the x-axis, we have elevation, and on the y-axis, we have species richness. I'm gonna present this as more of a linear model, just because it shows a little bit more effectively how dramatic the changes are between the two time points as opposed to a box plot. And so when we're looking at just the spruce zone, the lower parts of the high elevation ecosystem, we see a significant decline in species richness, or how many species are present within a plot. When we're going to the spruce fir zone, a few hundred meters above, we're again seeing a significant decline in species richness. And then finally at the fir zone, we again see a significant decline in species richness between the two time points. And you can really see as we increase in elevation, the difference between the two time points increases more and more. We can do the same thing for bryophyte abundance. This time we're looking at percent cover, or how much of those transect lines were covered by a bryophyte across the elevational gradient. And what we see at the lowest elevations in the spruce zone, there was no significant difference between bryophyte abundance between the two time points. Same thing for the spruce fir zone, no significant difference. But at the highest elevations in the fir zone, we do see a significant decline in percent cover between the two time points. And so we know that there are these different predictors that are predicting species richness and change in percent cover. We know that species richness has significantly declined across all elevation zones, but the only place where abundance has significantly declined was in the fir zone, those highest elevations. And while species richness and abundance are powerful metrics, we can combine them for even more powerful informative analysis, looking at bryophyte community turnover. And so I want to remind you all that these are pairwise comparisons between the two time points at the same exact plots. And so when we're thinking about bryophyte community turnover on the y-axis, when we see a turnover of zero, we're thinking about those two time points being exactly identical. There's been no turnover. There's been no changes in bryophyte community composition. Whereas at one, we're seeing two distinct communities being present at those plots between the two time points. We're going to be looking at turnover over various hill numbers or orders of Q. For those of you who are not familiar with those, they're just commonly used biodiversity metrics that are transformed in a way that we can compare within a hill number or within an order of Q. At Q of zero, we're going to be thinking about species richness, just presence, absence data, not thinking about how abundant those species are. At Q of one, we're going to be thinking about transect entropy, where abundance is started to be considered when determining how much turnover is occurring. And then finally at Q of two, we're looking at the inverse of Simpsons, where rare species are downweighted. And so when we're looking at all the different elevation zones at Q of zero, we see that there's high rates of bryophyte community turnover. When we go up and we start taking into consideration abundance at Shannon's entropy at hill number one, again, high rates of bryophyte community turnover. And the same thing happens when we're looking at just in the inverse of Simpsons, where rare species are downweighted. These letters indicate significance between groups within an order of a hill number. But the main take-home message of this figure is just to say that there's high bryophyte turnover across all elevations, regardless of how we weight our species in terms of abundance, in terms of rare species being upweighted or downweighted. And that in and of itself is really interesting, especially when we compare it to our other findings. Thinking about, again, species richness has significantly declined across all elevations, but only abundance has declined in the fir zone. However, there's been high rates of turnover regardless of these zones. What's really interesting about this is that in the spruce zone and the spruce-fir zone, we see those declines in species richness, but we don't see changes in abundance, but we still are seeing these high levels of turnover, suggesting that we're losing species, but the species that are remaining are filling in that space and increasing in abundance. Whereas at high elevations in the fir zone, we're seeing a decrease in species richness and a decrease in abundance with high rates of turnover, suggesting that there might be something else that's playing a role in driving these changes. And we can kind of compare this back to the Balsam Woolly Adelgid invasion and looking at another study in Poland that examined how bryophyte diversity in spruce forests changed between an invaded forest that was dead versus a healthy forest. In this study, they found that the dead stands actually had a greater species richness. When we think about our study, 2020 had far fewer species present than 2008. And so again, this Polish study, dead stands have great high species richness, whereas our 2008 time point also has high great species richness. When we also look at other parallels between the two studies, the dominant species within the dead Polish stands significantly declined within our plots within the park. And then the species that were common in those healthy Polish stands also increased in abundance in our park, just not significantly. So that might point us in a direction that the balsam, that we're recovering from the Balsam Woolly Adelgid invasion. However, my data doesn't directly test that or look at that. And so for future directions, I'd like to examine how bryophyte community has changed over longer periods of time, thinking about pre-Balsam Woolly Adelgid invasion versus post-Balsam Woolly Adelgid invasion, using herbarium specimens. I'd also like to compare the niches of declining versus stable species and kind of try to figure out where their future distributions will be, especially thinking about what variables might be important outside of the models that I tested already for this project. And I also want to examine how suitable habitat will change. So thinking about, will there be more suitable habitat? Will there be further decrease in suitable habitat under various climate change scenarios? With that, I'd like to thank my lab, especially my advisor, and my undergrad field help, Susanna Diamond, as well as my committee members for all their feedback, the UTK Herbarium for all of their funding support for this project, as well as Margaret Oliver, who was an incredible help with depositing and vouchering my specimens, and then especially the Great Smoky Mountains Natural Park for all of their help with this project, as well as allowing me to conduct this project within the park. And especially Paul Super for allowing me helping me get my permit for this project and overcoming a lot of hurdles. And with that, I'm happy to take any questions.